So now that Starship SN4 is gone, what are the next steps at Boca Chica? What is happening now? And when will SN5 be ready? Then we have another successful SpaceX Falcon 9 launch, just days after Crew Dragon Daemon 2 mission, namely another batch of Starlink satellites. And NASA is now searching for a new chief of human spaceflight, but it seems quite difficult to find someone who is willing to take the job.
And of course, we also have to talk about Space Force, come on.
Yes, the quite fun Netflix series, as well as the real Space Force, who now actively seeks industry partnerships. And meanwhile, the European Space Agency is trying to develop their own Raptor engine, and the Perseverance rover has arrived at Kennedy Space Center, where it is being prepared for a launch on the 17th of July towards Mars.
A lot to talk about as always, so stay tuned.
So now that SN4 is no more and the debris which still covered the explosion area last week has been removed, what is going on now at Boca Chica? Well, we remember that SN5 should have by now become the first prototype since the MK1 to be fully assembled, including nose cone and flaps. But of course now this has been delayed. SN5 and SN6, as can be seen here, are still waiting in the assembly building, with SN5 being already fully stacked and SN6 waiting for stacking. So not a lot of progress is going on here. However, we have a new launch mount, which replaced the old one, that had been damaged by the SN4 explosion. Also, a strange new dome appeared on the weekend, with many speculating what it could be. We are not 100% sure, but it could be a piece of SN7, which is rumored to be a test article for pressure tests, meaning SN7 will probably not be a full Starship prototype, but only a pressure vessel test prototype for cryogenic pressure tests. But this is just a theory, so, you know, we could be wrong. The next logical step will now of course be to get SN5 to the launch mount, and let's see when and if SN5 will get fully assembled, or if that role will now fall to SN6. In any case, we should see some major progress on SN5 and SN6 this week.
So while Doug and Bob have safely arrived at the ISS last week and are now acclimatizing to their new space habitat, another Falcon 9 rocket lifted off from Florida on Wednesday, just days after the successful launch of Daemon 2. The launch was another Starlink mission. These Starlink launches go up so often now. It has really become kind of the new normal. But this time the launch was something special. It marked the 10th anniversary of the first successful Falcon 9 launch. The Falcon 9 rocket made another record by completing its 5th flight and successfully landing on the drone ship. Just read the instructions. You really have to love the names of those drone ships. This Falcon 9 booster with the serial number B1049 will be the first one to make a 6th launch. So SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket is really nearing the 10 times reusability mark, which will become another huge milestone to further drive down the launch prices, much to the dismay of ULA and Roscosmos, of course. And also much to the dismay of the traditional internet service providers, since the number of operational Starlink satellites now stands with the addition of the latest batch of 60 new satellites at 475. Gwynne Shotwell said in an interview on the 25th of May that the Starlink network will go online once they have reached around 840 satellites. At the current launch rate, these will already be achieved by September or October. And coincidentally, during that time, the internal beta for Starlink will be launched, with the public beta following a bit later, but still in this year, for North American customers. The full public launch will happen early next year. Amazing times ahead for everyone who lives in rural areas with a slow internet connection. And of course, as we have said very often, Starlink will be a huge financial boost for SpaceX. In 2021, the revenue from Starlink will start to roll in, which will finance the construction of Elon's famous 1,000 Starship fleet.
And while SpaceX is having success after success, NASA is desperately seeking a new chief of human spaceflight after Doug Lovero left a big empty vacuum in that important position by leaving NASA on the 19th of May. We, by the way, speculated about the possible reasons why he could have left in this video here. NASA is now searching for someone to fill the post, and who would have thought no one wants to do the job? NASA Associate Administrator Steve Jurczyk said during a webinar on the 1st of June that they hope to find someone within weeks, hopefully not months. So being high up at NASA is somewhat of a brutal job these days, so therefore we totally understand that it's difficult to find a new one for the position. Let's just hope that this one won't quit so fast and will be more resilient, because we need a Jim Bridenstine type of person as chief of human spaceflight, since the Artemis moon landings can only happen with a strong leadership. With someone who won't instantly fold the moment there is political opposition. Because there will certainly be a lot of political opposition. In other news, the Space Force is now seeking new industry partnerships in the style of NASA, as Colonel Eric Felt, head of the Air Force Research Laboratory Space Vehicles Directorate, said at a spacenews.com online event on June the 4th. Felt said that NASA's Commercial Crew program is super exciting and one that the Space Force can learn from. The huge success of the Demo 2 mission is very inspirational, and the Space Force will certainly want to launch their own vessels into space as soon as possible. Colonel Felt didn't provide any specific details on future plans in that regard, but we strongly assume that as soon as Starship will prove flightworthy and will be human-rated, Space Force will certainly be highly interested in partnering up with SpaceX in order to have their very own starships. And the Space Force series on Netflix is quite funny, by the way. We watched a few episodes and had some good laughs. This video is not sponsored by them or anything, we just thought we had to mention that Netflix has decided to produce a comedy series on the topic of Space Force, which we think is an awesome idea. The first season is already certainly quite promising.
And apparently the European Space Agency, ESA, has now finally woken up and realized that they must improve themselves in order to stay in the rocket launch business. Because not only ULA and Roscosmos are being totally hammered by SpaceX, no, ESA with their Ariane rockets is now also feeling the strong pressure SpaceX is putting on all rocket launch providers worldwide. For the longest time, it seemed as if ESA just didn't want to acknowledge that SpaceX is growing so fast and becoming so powerful that it could put them out of business, or to put them into such a position that they can only be kept alive by being subsidized by the European Union. But now ESA has announced that they are working on their own Raptor-style rocket engine, which they hope to become also reusable. They call the new rocket engine Prometheus, after the Titan in Greek mythology who created humans from clay and who defied the gods, stole fire, and gave it to humans. And oh yes, that's also the name of the quite mediocre alien prequel movie. Like Starship's Raptor engine, ESA's engine will be also based on liquefied oxygen and methane, which in itself is actually quite interesting, because most other space agencies are only focusing on oxygen and hydrogen. So ESA is choosing to follow the path of SpaceX with their Starship and Raptor engines. Furthermore, ESA is also trying to reduce the costs of their current engine production by a factor of 10. So ESA's end goal is to make their engines reusable, like the Raptor engines from SpaceX. And they also want their new engine to be very flexible, including features like variable thrust, multiple ignitions, being suitable for main and upper stages, and also allowing for minimized ground operations before and after flight. This sounds quite good to us, and we hope that ESA will be able to mass produce this new engine in time. And hopefully they will also soon start to produce fully reusable rockets. Otherwise, they wouldn't be able to play any significant role in human spaceflight in the future, just like Roscosmos and ULA. And actually, we'd like ESA to put their pride away and to start working together with SpaceX and then use Starships for crewed European moon missions. But this will probably remain wishful thinking. So now, finally, onto the topic of Mars. The 2020 Mars rover, which goes under the name Perseverance, has arrived at Kennedy Space Center and is now being prepared for launch to Mars on the 17th of July.
And why is this mission so highly amazing, you ask? Well, because the goal is to search for life on Mars. One of its instruments, with a quite innovative acronym SHERLOCK, will search for organic molecules of biological origin that would be signs of life. We shouldn't forget that the possibility that some microbes or even a bit higher developed life, for example sponges or the like, might be living deep in the caves and lava tubes of Mars is actually not even so low. After all, the two Viking probes that landed on Mars in 1976 returned positive signals for the presence of microbes by detecting microbial respiration. They, however, didn't detect organic molecules in the soil, so the signals were dismissed. And actually, to this day, the results are hotly debated. Gilbert Levin, who was the principal investigator for the labeled release life detection experiment on both landers, still maintains that Viking really did discover life. Hopefully, Perseverance with its Sherlock instrument will clarify this to some extent by answering the question if organic molecules of biological origin are present in the Martian soil or not, despite the perchlorate salts, which are not really friendly to life as we know it. But then again, Martian life could act quite differently and maybe even use the perchlorates as an energy source.
Hopefully, Sherlock will give us some answers, even though it will also only be a clue, not a definitive proof, because for that we would need an updated version of the Viking experiment. It seems that for definitive proof of life, we would have to wait until the first humans arrive on Mars. That life will most likely not be dangerous to us. But of course, keeping strict quarantine measures and safety protocols will certainly not hurt. When the first humans arrive on Mars with Starship in 5 to 15 years, depending on your personal level of optimism.
So what do you say to the European version of the Raptor engine? Will ESA be fast enough to build it in order to have a chance against SpaceX?
And based on the current progress of Starship at Boca Chica, we have an updated analysis of Elon's famous Mars colonization timeline. If you have missed that video, you can watch it right here.
So thanks as always for watching the JS Space Report, and then I would say, on to the future. Oh, see you next Friday. What? Did I press now? I also forgot this time. Okay, yes, it's recording.